So there are 3-4 questions and they are quite interconnected, which we'll take it up. Two of them are very interesting. One is, of course, I'm very surprised that this is the first time someone has asked this question in so many years, but it's a very interesting question. Whether Sri Aurobindo's yoga is some kind of a Hinduism or an extension of Hinduism. And the second is, of course, about Mother and Sri Aurobindo's life. And actually the two are interconnected because we cannot separate one from the other, as we shall see. The question sounds very simple and direct, but it's quite subtle. It has many ramifications. And so perhaps the best way to answer is to speak a little bit about Sri Aurobindo's life and then leave each one of us to decide for ourselves. As some of us may know and some of us may not, some who are very new, at a very young age of 7, Sri Aurobindo was sent from Darjeeling in India to the UK for studies, where he studied for nearly 14 years, completing his graduation at Cambridge, ICS at Cambridge. And he did very well. He was regarded as among the most brilliant student. His father had wanted him to keep away from any exposure to Indian culture because he felt that it is inferior. Well, this was a kind of indoctrination, if one may say so. But he tried his best to keep him away, much like the Buddha, whose father tried to keep him away from anything that may disturb the little prince's idea about life. He was shown only the beautiful side of life, and Sri Aurobindo was exposed only to the rising sun or the risen sun of England. So much so that at one point of time, his caretaker, they even baptized Sri Aurobindo. Took him to the church where he was christened as Aurobindo Acroyd Ghosh. Now, all this carried on, and there Sri Aurobindo mastered Greek, Latin, Spanish, English, of course, among many other things, but remained largely alien to the Indian culture. This is the first part. But when he comes back to India, he has a series of experiences which lead him to a deeper study of Indian thought. And very few probably would have surmised how deep he is going to go into that. Some of his key experiences, for instance, one while walking on the seat of Solomon in Kashmir, he described it as the Advaita experience of the vacant infinite. Another, while he is looking at the image of Kali, he suddenly has the experience of the World Mother. Similarly, in Saras Bagh in Pune, which also he has immortalized in his poem, that on a stairway as he climbs and sees the stone goddess. Actually, it is the image of Parvati, and he has another experience. So experiences came flowing into him. He also practiced certain aspects of Indian yoga, pranayama, for instance, 6 to 8 hours a day for many months, not what we call as pranayama, and discovered that it led to an intense flow of creativity. Poetries, lines after lines would flow. There were certain changes also in his physical being which he noticed. But it didn't take him beyond that. So then at one point of time in his life, there came more and more the presence of Sri Krishna. And Sri Aurobindo would several times refer to it, and in a letter to one of his disciples, he even says that there was a great role that Krishna played in my own life and yoga. And also his identification grew with Sri Krishna's counterpart in the evolutionary play, that is Kali. So much so that Sri Aurobindo would many times sign off his letters as Kali. He would write at the end Kali, not his name, and this was one side of it. In the course of his yoga, some key experiences, for instance of Nirvana, came while Vishnu Bhaskar Lele, a yogi from more of a bhakti tradition, he came, and within 3 days Sri Aurobindo had completely experienced the silent consciousness and the Nirvana, which otherwise comes after probably many lives, not just years of rigorous practice. And then we also know that while he was in the Alipur jail, he had second major experience, and he had this experience of Vasudevam Sarvamiti, what is described in the Gita as the rarest of rare experiences, where he saw Vasudeva in the food he was eating, Vasudeva in the bowl, Vasudeva in the bars of the cell, prison cell, Vasudeva in the blanket, Vasudeva in the tree, Vasudeva in the jailers, Vasudeva in the advocate who was fighting for him, and Vasudeva in the advocate who was fighting against him, and Vasudeva in the judge, and Vasudeva everywhere. And the mother has spoken of this experience. She said it is the supramental experience, but he used the word Narayana, Vasudeva, because of a certain background. This is another major experience that we see in Sri Aurobindo's life. While he was in jail, he had many other experiences which actually belong in a certain sense to the tradition of Hindu life and experience, yogic experience. For instance, one of the things, one of the two slokas which was very dear to him, which he would often recite in the jail, are from the Isha Upanishad. And Sri Aurobindo would later on say that Isha Upanishad lays the foundations of the divine life. You are talking about the divine life, and its first glimpse is there in the Isha Upanishad. So he speaks about it. He of course also studied the Upanishads and later on the Vedas. The Vedas, because he started having a series of psychological experiences, including visitations of the gods, the goddesses, and scripts coming in front of him, the etheric scripts, the mantras, etc. And he found their confirmation in the Vedas. So it's very interesting that when he read the Vedas, he said, oh, here is an explanation to all that I'm experiencing. It's not that he studied the Vedas and then had these experiences. And subsequently, of course, we also know that from 1914 to 1919, Sri Aurobindo started expressing his thoughts after the mother's coming first time when she came, in the form of a journal which he named as Arya. And then he explained why he has called it the Arya, because Arya is a word which is very much Indian, and in India the noble, the Sreshtha, the highest type of humanity was regarded as Arya. It was not a racial term. So he had to explain to the audience that why he has used the term Arya and who is an Arya. And he explains the Arya is not a geographical type but a psychological type of humanity. And whoever tries to exceed himself and climb the hills of knowledge and wisdom and is strong enough to fight against the darkness that surrounds us, the darkness of ignorance and unconsciousness, is an Aryan. So he spoke about it way back. And then among his major works or things which were serialized in the Arya, we see his translations and some commentaries on the principal Upanishads. And then he speaks about the secret of the Vedas, which has a very interesting history. Sri Aurobindo at one place mentions that Sri Krishna came to me, as we know he had a very intimate relation with Sri Krishna, and placed the Gita in my hands, and the strength of the Gita entered into my being, and then I realized the eternal truths of Sanatana Dharma. So he speaks about that. As soon as he came out of the jail, he had given this famous speech called Uttar Para speech, where he speaks about the truth of Sanatana Dharma. And Sri Krishna also gave him a new Nirukta, which helped him in decoding the secret of the Vedas. So secret of the Vedas was, his commentary is not a commentary purely based on grammar, but a commentary which flows directly from his experience and from a new understanding of the Vedas based on the Nirukta given to him by Sri Krishna himself. These are in Sri Aurobindo's words. Nothing is mine in this. And apart from Upanishad and the Vedas, we know that he wrote the commentary on Essays on the Gita, and the mother said that Gita has already been a very important scripture in terms of helping humanity free itself from ignorance, and with this new commentary given by Sri Aurobindo, new interpretation, its action has become even more powerful. So this, with this background, Sri Aurobindo writes in the Synthesis of Yoga that our yoga starts from the method of the Vedanta and to fulfill the aim of the Tantra. So now he brings a new element in his dimension in his yoga. That is, he brings in not only Vedantic thought but also Tantra. In a famous letter of his, he speaks about the Vedantic idea. This letter is to Maharani of Baroda, where he says that Sri Aurobindo's teaching starts from the ancient teaching of Vedanta of the one reality behind all things. So this is the Vedantic aspect of the teaching. But here one must make clear that Sri Aurobindo's understanding of the Vedanta and his experience, his interpretation, is not same as Shankara's and subsequent interpretations of the Vedanta, which speak about the world as an illusion. Sri Aurobindo, on the contrary, says the world is a distortion, not an illusion. It is illusion only in the sense that it doesn't fully represent the reality which is hiding behind it. So there is a reality which is expressing itself through the world, not standing aloof away from the world. It is trying to express, and yet the expression is distorted, and therefore it should become a perfect expression. So herein, Sri Aurobindo begins to differentiate his yoga from the traditional Vedantic yoga. In the traditional Vedantic yoga, there is creation, which is basically a movement of Prakriti. There are many kinds of philosophical understanding of it, the Prakriti playing in the consciousness of the Purusha. Let's not go into it. Philosophy is all right for, you know, losing our head, but not for walking the path. So it's one side of it, but if there are questions, we can talk about it. But he says that this reality is not just a passive reality, not just a witness, but a dynamic reality expressing itself through nature, through creation. So herein comes the Tantra element. And we see a large portion of Tantra in his yoga also. For instance, worship of the Divine Mother, it's directly from the Tantra. His famous letter on the four aspects of the Divine Mother and the four names he gives, Maheshwari, Mahakali, Mahalakshmi, Mahasaraswati, we know are from the Chandi. Those who are familiar with Chandi would know that, recognize that these are the four names of the Divine Mother given in the Chandi. And we have already spoken about Kali, and Sri Aurobindo had many, many kinds of experiences with many of these beings, and that's how his sadhana proceeded. But having said that, Sri Aurobindo did go beyond the traditional understanding of Hinduism. I am not even speaking of the ritualistic side. The ritualistic side of any religion is temporal. It's not something eternal or permanent. It is bound to go away, whether in Hinduism or any other religion, because rituals, and by rituals I mean a strictly external kind of living in which religion begins to fossilize itself. But the core of Hinduism, he said, has something very deep, very profound, very vast, and it is still continues to pay service to mankind. That is how he saw Hinduism. And from that, we may say that Sri Aurobindo's new idea sprang up from its roots, but went way ahead, much further. We also know that in the jail, Sri Aurobindo had visitation by Swami Vivekananda, most probably his mental body, as Sri Aurobindo says later on. And he is the one who showed him the way to the supermind. Sri Aurobindo acknowledges that. So there are many, many kinds of touches of both Hindu experience and Hindu thought in Sri Aurobindo's yoga and writings. And then his yoga extends Now, where does it extend and where does it begin to differentiate itself? Well, in traditional Hindu thought and experience as it is understood today, I wouldn't say that as it was understood in the age of the Vedas, because in the age of the Vedas, the Vedic rishis did speak about the fullness of the manifestation, trying to make the heaven and earth equal and one. But over a period of time, it became very otherworldly. And Sri Aurobindo once again sets the clock right and says, as far as I am concerned, I cannot make a distinction between this worldly and otherworldly, because for me, both experiences came together. Most of his major experiences were while he was in the middle of life. For instance, in Barodhara, the famous experience of the Godhead, while the chariot, while the the car in which he was traveling, suddenly the wheel came out and he saw the Godhead emerge and holding the reins, and he's immortalized in his poem, The Godhead. So many of these experiences came while he was in the middle of life, and he continued with those experiences his work. So he brings something new also to the Hindu thought. For instance, in Hindu thought, we speak about evolution. It is a mistake to believe that Sri Aurobindo borrowed the idea of evolution from Darwin. It's a gross error that is made by many modern historians, because Sri Aurobindo himself writes that the theory of evolution is already there in Indian thought. For instance, in Vedanta, there is the whole idea of evolution of the soul. That's how it goes through different forms. The whole story of transmigration is about evolution till it reaches a human form, and in the human form, it's ready to evolve further. Then he speaks about the 84 lakh yonis which are spoken of in Tantra, and they are again directly about the evolution. Then about the 10 avatars, the parable of the 10 avatars, which is about not only the evolution of consciousness, but also the evolution of form. So the ideas are there, but it stops at some point of time. And Sri Aurobindo brings these thoughts, to these ideas and experiences, to its ultimate fullness, that, well, evolution is not going to stop with man, but will go beyond man. Now, in Vedanta also, there is talk of going beyond man, but no more in a body. The human body is the ultimate culmination of creation. And after the human body, all that the soul needs to do is to arrive at its fullness through meditation, through contemplation, through various kinds of yogic practices, and it can get out of this human body and the cycle of birth and death into union with the divine and be done with this life. But Sri Aurobindo says, no, human beings or human body is not the ultimate. There is a greater destiny bequeathed to earth and man, and that destiny will fulfill itself in the form of a new being, a new creation here upon earth. Now, this we don't find in Hindu thought, or for that matter, any thought. So there is something very new, very powerful. And as we were saying in the morning session, it brings a new hope for all of us that the aim of the yoga is not just an individual salvation or nirvana or the beyond, but to bring that beyond here upon earth. At the same time, we see that Sri Aurobindo also pays homage to certain other lines of spiritual experiences, because it will be an error to believe, well, though India is a land which has been the guardian of the Sanatana Dharma, it has experimented along many, many, many lines of spiritual experiences, mind-boggling. I mean, it is the laboratory of spiritual experiences, if one wants to put it like that. At the same time, spiritual experiences, the spiritual consciousness, the mystery of the divine has been felt and touched lives in various parts of the world, in various cultures, past and present. And it's going to be like that, because the divine is not confined to one geographical unit, even though he may choose that particular place for his work in a major way. Yet his work has continued. And herein Sri Aurobindo interestingly includes Christ in the avatars. Among the 10 avatars, he speaks about Christ. He also speaks about the 4 major events in the history of earth, where he says one is the siege of Troy, the Trojan War, and the second one is crucifixion of Christ, which humanized Europe. The third is Krishna's exile from Vrindavan, which created devotional religion. Before that, we had Jnana and But bhakti came later on. And the fourth is the colloquy on the battlefield of the Kurukshetra, which is the Gita, which will yet liberate humanity. He also speaks of Christ, and there is a direct reference to Christ in Savitri. Now we see Savitri itself. The story is a Vedic story. It's from the Vedic age. And which Sri Aurobindo is regarded as his magnum opus. Sri Aurobindo regarded the Ramayana and the Mahabharata and Vyasa and Valmiki and of course also Kalidas as ranking among the greatest of poets which have ever been born. They are seer poets. But he also includes Homer as a seer poet. He has written nearly a hundred page poem which covers that aspect of the Trojan War which Homer has not spoken of. That period when they are waiting and when the, you know, Homer has written about the war and of course the great journey of Odysseus as he returns back after the war, his meeting of Telemachus and then finally how the Greek tribes come together. It's a very interesting story. But Sri Aurobindo writes about that period which Homer doesn't speak about. And it's amazing. It's so real. It brings the whole war so near to us, the whole story so near to us. So there are many aspects, many strands of past spiritual experiences which Sri Aurobindo has taken into himself. We also know that among the four major darshan days in the ashram, 15th August, Sri Aurobindo's birthday, 21st February, the mother's birthday, 24th April, the mother's final arrival to Pondicherry, and the fourth one, 24th November. Now, 24th November is known as the Siddhi day in the ashram, and it's very well known that, what the mother and Sri Aurobindo and many disciples had to say about it. The mother says it was the day when Sri Krishna's personality, the avatar, that formation of the Supreme from the past, fused into Sri Aurobindo's physical consciousness. So it's something very directly, and this was in 1926, after which the whole the serious effort to bring the supermind down to earth started. So we can see that there are many aspects of both Vedantic and the thoughts of Tantra, experiences of Tantra in Sri Aurobindo's yoga. But at the same time, Sri Aurobindo has not taken up Hinduism in a very narrow and limited way. But the true Hinduism, the Sanatana Dharma, because of which many streams of spiritual experiences came to India, and in an effort to conquer India, were conquered by its spiritual impulse. It's so strange and interesting that we see the Greeks, the Portuguese, the Europeans and many others who came to India were eventually conquered by India's spiritual thought. And while they looted India, and it's a fact, and I make no bones about this fact, India, while they were carrying the loot, also gave them in addition a gift. And it was the gift of Indian spirituality. It is amazing that, while India's physical wealth was being plumaged and plundered, literally if I see India as a goddess, she would say, wait, 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 you are not yet carrying the real treasure which I can give you. All this you may take, but I have a treasure which can rebuild the entire India. And again, what is it that you are holding back? Wait, 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 take it from me. And it is the Gita, the Vedas, which went, and now we know how all over the world this has come up in a big way. It doesn't matter. India never wanted that people should acknowledge it as traditional Vedanta or call it in this way or this religion or that religion, because it has always transcended religions. In India, it was not, in fact, the word Hindu is first used by Alexander simply because he had to give a name for the civilization which grew around Indus Valley, and he called it Hindus, which became Hindus. And one of the yogis, Kalanos, who was Kalyan actually, who was taken by Alexander all the way to Greece, he learned from this yogi. So this has been, to that extent, no doubt Sri Aurobindo has spoken very, very highly both of India and the spiritual experiments here, the manifestation of the divine, but he also includes the Buddha and Christ in that scheme of things, speaks about Christ, as I was saying. There are passages very directly in Savitri. At one place he says that when the divine comes upon earth, humanity gives the cross in payment for the crown. And then he says that the crowd jeer at him, two thieves slain by his side. and Gethsemane and Calvary are his lot. And he speaks about directly about the divine advent upon earth. So it's so obvious that he is referring to Christ as the advent. Even about the mother of seven sorrows. There are several references to Christian mysticism in Savitri and many other places in Sri Aurobindo's writings. So he represents, if I may say so, the highest synthesis that has been possible till now in spiritual thought and lines of experiences. Sri Aurobindo in his yoga synthesizes both Indian line of spiritual experiences and the Western line of spiritual experiences. He synthesizes within Indian thought Vedanta and Tantra, which have, we know how they have fought with each other. He also synthesizes the diverse lines, you know, people, the Vaishnavites and Shaivites have fought. And Sri Aurobindo in one of his poems so beautifully mentions, but Shiva and Krishna are a single God. And there are several places where he speaks about Shiva and he speaks about Krishna and brings their truth so beautifully. I mean, it's really to be studied. And probably even if one were to write many, many books on this subject, it won't be enough on Sri Aurobindo's life. We also see a similar phenomena taking place in Mother's life. Born in the Western context in France from a completely positivist background, extremely materialistic background, where she was taught literally not to believe in God. Just like Sri Aurobindo was kept away from Indian culture, the mother's physical parents, particularly her physical mother, wanted her to be totally grounded on earth, that matter alone is real, what you can touch, see, hear and feel is real. And she says, it was thanks to this that I would not be content with any experience which I experienced only inside. I had to see it completely objectively on the surface, on the very matter. And that's why she was so beautifully prepared for the yoga of the body and yoga of the cells. At the same time, the mother's delving into the occult, she brings up the best of Egyptian traditions and that kind of occultism through Theon. And subsequently, her spiritual journey also begins with a copy of the Gita which she is given. It's a very bad translation, she says, in French, which was given by Yashoda Ma's husband. I think many people may not know. That means Krishna Prem's guru, her husband. And the mother reads it and she realizes the truth of the Gita. As Krishna as the immanent divine within and Arjuna as the human soul. And she realizes the truth of the Gita within a few months. She also read and translated the Ish Upanishad, Bhakti Sutras of Narad, even before coming to India. Very few people are probably aware, but in her own handwriting, some portions of the Ish Upanishads exist in Sanskrit. So she also had interesting experiences. We know her experiences with Buddha or Sakyamuni, and most of all, she used to meet many saints and yogis in her body sleep, as she would come out of the body, and they would come and give her instructions. Now, one of them, with one of these beings, she had a very interesting relation. And he became like a permanent person coming to her. And she called him Krishna. And she knew nothing about Indian tradition, that there is someone like Krishna. This is right much earlier, this used to come. But when she went and stood before Sri Aurobindo for the first time, she realized the Krishna of her visions. And she says, I used to earlier think it's some Greek god because the dhoti was like this. It's an apparition. But she would call Krishna. And yet when she stood before Sri Aurobindo, she recognized in him the Krishna of her visions. And therefore she wrote this beautiful little passage from her prayers and meditation, her diary of spiritual diary, record of spiritual diary, where she notes, he whom we saw yesterday is here upon earth. His presence is enough to prove that a day will come when all this darkness will be transformed into light. Just his presence is enough. So she saw in him the same Krishna whom she would. And then later on, while in the ashram context, there are so many relations that the mother formed with the God. She would say that the Trimurtis would come, the goddesses would come. how she would walk with Krishna. There are many interesting stories of the mother with these gods and goddesses. Durga would come and with a particular devotee of Durga, whom she didn't know is a devotee of Durga, but after seeing, he goes away and the mother asked someone who would accompany her that, is she a devotee of Durga? Yes, mother. Oh, no wonder, Durga came with her. So when she came, Durga came with her. And she would talk about Shiva and she would describe him that he's tall, like he's shown majestic with that red gold color. And he told her that, look, I would help you in this work which you are doing, but I won't take a human body. So it's exactly what is mentioned even in Shiva's legends, that he won't take a human body. And he says, but I would help. In what? Destruction of the ego, physical ego. And Sri Aurobindo says, no, not yet. And the whole process stopped. And then she would say that for many days, weeks, months, she would walk with Krishna. And it was so delightful. And then after a while, Sri Aurobindo began to walk with her. And then she says, ah, this is blissful. I don't want to do anything else. And then the moment Sri Aurobindo knew this, he disappeared. And she says, after that, I said, no, now I want to walk only with Supreme in his own form. Nobody else. And then she says, first Krishna, then Sri Aurobindo, then the Supreme. She had visions of the Supreme. She says, more grand than the vision of the Gita. So actually, we cannot really cabin them into any particular line of thought. In fact, no true mystic can even ever cabin. So when the mother spoke about going beyond religion, it's also true that the mother said that the age of religions is over. All the religions, and whether we like it or not, we don't have to do anything. The children are not going to accept and adopt it. Just a question of time. And why? Because religions had their beauty and grace, but religions also had their flip side. And over a period of time, the religions were lost in their externalities, in the rituals, in strict following of traditions. And the core of religions, which is spiritual, that began to get lost. So it had to be destroyed. In India, we have the legend of Sati. Sati's body is destroyed by Vishnu. And who is Sati? She is none else but the Divine Mother's incarnation. And yet her body is destroyed. We also have the story of Chinnamasta, where the Divine Mother destroys her own, beheads herself. So basically it's that outer forms have to be destroyed so that the inner truths can be released and given a new form more appropriate to the age. So religions were very helpful to mankind up till a certain point. But beyond a point, they have become counterproductive. And we can see that in the last I think the youngest religion is Islam. And perhaps no new religions have been born, or perhaps Sikhism if you want to put it. But subsequently, for many, many centuries, there have been no new religions. Mankind is being prepared for something else. And we have to go beyond religions. The other part is when we talk about going beyond religions, the mother spoke about going beyond the domain of the gods. That in religions, even the most greatest experiences, the dazzling splendors that humanity experienced or the mystics experienced, were the splendors of the overmind consciousness. And now humanity is ready to exceed it and go beyond it. So it is also true that they said that the age of religions is over. And religions, no religion, Eastern or Western, can fully satisfy the growing spiritual impulse of mankind. It has to go beyond it if it has to survive and find its true solution. So this is in a nutshell this question about Sri Aurobindo and Hinduism. Each one can derive one's own conclusions from this. My own take is that yes, Sri Aurobindo did see in Hinduism a great potential for the future life of humanity. He also saw in the core of Hindu thought something very beautiful, still alive and real, which is waiting for a new form and a new body, and he gave that to it. At the same time, he also saw in other past spiritual efforts Christ's advent, for example, and Buddha, for instance, beautiful things which are which he took up for the future life of humanity. And even in Sikhism, for instance, he saw the first effort to form a spiritualized society. He speaks about it. And he says that why it failed, that also reasons he gives. So this is a very interesting area and subject. And at the same time, he left human beings free. So it's not that, though in the ashram context, we'll see that certain forms of practices which may look like Hindu, for instance, you know, people go and the samadhi is arranged with beautiful flowers and there are incense sticks, etc. But nobody is compelled to follow any particular ritual. It's a very beautiful thing about the ashram. That's not that you have to accept, this god or that god or this method of practice or that way. It doesn't matter. The mother repeatedly insisted on sincerity, 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 aspiration, rejection, surrender. These are the core elements, the core values. The core values are not belief in gods and goddesses. The core values are not subscribing to this or that philosophy or line of thought. In fact, they are obstacles. So this also they made it very clear that when we are tied to one kind of spiritual experience or one framework or structure of, which is born out of spiritual experience, then we limit the play of the infinite within us. That's what we were speaking of in the morning, that it is the way of the infinite Shakti. And we cannot decide or say that this is how the divine should act and not this way. He may reveal himself in so many ways. He will reveal himself even to the materialist if there is genuineness. He may withhold himself from the eyes of a very religious man. And in Indian thought, we have such stories. Ravana was very religious. At one place, Sri Aurobindo says, some asuras are very religious. So simply by going to a temple and how many times one goes to the temple or a mosque or a church, one cannot decide how spiritual a person is. So he speaks about grace coming to St. Augustine and Jagai and Maghai of infamous fame in Chaitanya's example. So in spirituality, there is a very wide, free and plastic approach because we are approaching a consciousness that is infinite. And while certain frameworks, again, are relevant to us at a certain stage of evolution. But it would be a great error to impose these frameworks on others or believe these are the only frameworks or even for oneself to stick to that framework. So there are people who start with their belief in Krishna or Christ and turn towards Sri Aurobindo. It's fine. Nobody is there to tell that this is right or wrong or no, you should not think. This is a question of growth. When the time comes, we grow into a different consciousness. We discover who they are. So there is also a third question, whether they are avatar or not. It's a question which is, ideally it's a question which should be answered by Sri Aurobindo and the mother into the consciousness of each of one of us. Of course, the mother spoke of Sri Aurobindo as the avatar, and Sri Aurobindo spoke of the mother as the divine mother herself, who has taken a human body, and they are avatars in that sense. But if we turn it into a dogma to be believed by all, it will become like another religious movement. Each one, it will be a revelation. There is a very beautiful line in Ramayana, "So janahi jin Ram janahi." He whom the divine chooses to reveal himself, that person understands. So it doesn't matter. It's not that we cannot follow the yoga unless we accept the supremacy of Sri Aurobindo as the avatar. It's not necessary. Sri Aurobindo, if that is necessary for the relationship, will reveal himself. Somebody may see in him the master. Somebody may see in him as a guru. Someone may see in him as a great thinker and just feel an admiration. Well, he would accept all kinds of approaches. But of course, it is also true that ultimately, if we really want to give our 100% and derive the 100% out of yoga, then it's best to use the phrase of the Gita, Sarva Bhavin Bharata. In all ways, in every way of our being and becoming, we should surrender to them. But this obviously is a special grace. It is not something which can be told and imposed. And it's something which grows upon us. It's not, I remember my parents at they used to be very not happy that I have found a god in Pondicherry. Because India is full of gods. And they were also very traditional with Rama and Krishna and very, very like bhakti. So they said, why did you have to find a god all the way in Pondicherry? Because the problem was my holidays, in Air Force used to be eaten up. So I would go all the way to Pondicherry. They wanted me to come to them. So they would have been happy if there was a god nearby, some guru nearby. And it was very difficult to explain to them. So at times I had to simply tell a lie. I use the word spiritual lie. So I would say, I am not getting leave to come. And go to Pondicherry, and thank God there were no mobiles. So I would write 4 letters, because they expected a letter a week. So 4 letters dated 4 different dates. Leave it with my friend, dates written behind in pencil, to rub off and post it. And friends were very nice and accommodating, and the play continued. But then a day came when my parents could not, coming from a very traditional Hindu thought, they would say, it's all right, but I don't understand, their issue was that in the ashram, in dining room, do they put onions? Because I was from a background where onion and garlic meant that you are gone, destroyed, the boys become corrupt. I said, you can make out onion or not, you take it and see. I didn't have the courage to tell them, yes, there is onion. And they took it, and my mom, who was so sensitive to picking up onion, couldn't pick up. And she enjoyed the dining room food, so I just thanked the mother quietly. So it started like that they liked the dining room food, before accepting mother and she. And then, once or twice I saw that morning, 5 o'clock, when I would wake up. My father used to wake up at 3 o'clock, take his bath, do his puja and everything. So by 5 he was all ready. So he would be quietly reading books of mother, sitting in my meditation hall. But the moment he would see me, he would quickly keep it and come out, and as if, by the way, I was reading it. I said, it's okay, by the way, you read it. And how they turned, he had such a beautiful experience at Matri Mandir, and my mother towards the end, all her malas, she was a tapaswini, so she would do all kinds of malas from Shiva and Krishna and Rama, and ultimately her first meal would be at 12 noon after all this puja. But towards the end, she would tell me that, whose mala I am doing? No, mommy, I knew, I was wanting to hear from her own mouth, I am calling mother. I used to feel very touched inside. And this happened at an old age. But in the beginning, when I would try vociferously to tell them, you don't know, mommy, what mother and Sri Aurobindo are. They would say, no, I can see you are now misguided after studying in AFMC Pune. You have become very westernized. They thought that it's some kind of a westernized, line of thought. And it's very difficult to tell people, read the synthesis. Or, another issue many people had, oh, she was a French lady, as if God cannot be French. I mean, it's strange, particularly in the Indian context, where God could be fish and he could be, kachua, tortoise. I mean, if he could be fish and turtle, French are definitely better. I mean, by all standards, at least humans. So what if a little arrogant humans? But humans with a lovely language. French is a beautiful language, for that matter. A beautiful language with such a poetic melody in it. So, these very orthodox and conventional mindset is really not ready for any kind of yoga. Leave aside Sri Aurobindo's yoga. It means we are still too much confined. At the same time, there are, within these confines, there is some spark which lights up. Because any sincere person, when we read the various philosophies and go to the depths, because many of these things we have just adopted and accepted because we were born in it. And if we really have the quest, then we cannot really be satisfied. No Indian, at least I was not satisfied with the traditional theory of karma and where you have papa and punya. And similarly, I'm sure Christian who looks deep into his own religion would ever be satisfied with God damning somebody into eternal hell where even God can't reach. It would be very difficult to accept these kind of propositions. Or any follower of Buddha to say that Buddha's anatman means there is no divinity when he is speaking about the permanent. So, if we go deep, most of us have not really read. This is the unfortunate part. And this applies even in Sri Aurobindo's yoga. Very often I hear people saying that, what is the method? What is the method of practice? Sri Aurobindo himself has written there is no method and all methods. Now, how can I improvise upon that? Nobody can improvise. He has said the Divine Mother is doing the yoga. Categorically, he has made it very, very, very clear. So we don't have to do yoga. The yoga is done by the Divine Mother in us. So what do we do? Well, we have to surrender and open to the Divine Mother. That requires tremendous courage, faith, and inner psychological attitudes which we have to acquire. This is the whole, and how do we acquire these psychological attitudes? Not by reading a book, okay, I need to have balance, for instance. So, okay, balance, no. We will meet in life enough situations where we have to adopt either this attitude or the other attitude. And that's how this yoga proceeds. So Sri Aurobindo also says that the process of this yoga, she takes, the infinite Shakti takes up every part of her nature. At the end, she wants to create a perfect perfection. So it's not enough that we have illuminations in the mind and a darkness in the heart. That we are, you know, great intellectuals who can deliberate and debate on the life divine and be very scholarly, but this is all dry, empty, void. We turn Sri Aurobindo into a very impersonal something. No, it's not enough. At the same time, it's not enough that we are very devotional and say, yes, yes, I know, I sing nice bhajans to Sri Aurobindo, but there is no illumination here. This too must open up, as we said, the medha being offered as sacrifice into the fire of aspiration. At the same time, it's not enough that we just follow the traditional bhakti and the traditional opening of the mind towards jnana. We must also become his servants, his instruments, his channels for his work in the world. So even the life impulse, the life energy, the will has to align itself to the Divine Mother by surrendering itself. How do we surrender the will? Very simple. All the time this will is usurped by the ego. And from here we get the mantra of the divine life. Our will is given to the ego and ego uses it. And the will is accepted to enter the womb of the ego so that eventually it will blast it off. But nevertheless, for a long time, we say, I want to do this, I want to do that. So we don't even care to see what the divine wants in us. So when we start like that, I want this, and things don't happen according to the way we want. Now we can take one of the two attitudes. One, that the divine doesn't exist. Easy. Finished. No more problems. But the second we can take, perhaps what I want is one thing and the divine wants something else. This is the second attitude. Now the moment we take the second attitude, automatically we are beginning to align our individual will to the divine will. Very simple. So we start with what is called in the Gita as Nishkam Karma. If we perfect this approach, we start by what we want is natural, valid, and we offer it to the divine. When things go our way, thank the divine. When things don't go our way, thank him even more profusely. That means he has seriously taken up the yoga. There's a very nice story about someone, you know, in Odisha, who asked an Odia sadhak, Prapattiji, who used to be with Babaji Maharaj, some of us may not know. And, you know, he asked Prapattiji, you know, in my life, everything is going good, so nice. And he said, maybe the Divine Mother has not yet looked at you. You know, and he was shocked. What does it mean? It is like that. It's a fact that, you know, there are many things in life which don't go our way. Most of us at that point of time take this old attitude, my way or no way. Even God must follow my way, otherwise he is no more God. But we can take another attitude. My way is not necessarily the best way. However highly I may think of myself, I may be a Harvard graduate, I may be, you know, a damn good professional in whatever field, I may be an authority on Vedanta and Upanishads, and yet I may not know what the divine will is. Whereas Ramakrishna, who knew nothing in terms of externalities. And yet Vedanta flowed through his lips. So beautifully he had seized the core. I mean, if one reads the gospel, Sri Aurobindo has spoken so highly of Sri Ramakrishna himself. One of the things that he got from when he came to Pondicherry, very few people may know about this. I do not know if some people are aware or not, that two things that Sri Aurobindo brought with him to Pondicherry. One is the mitti, the mud of Dakshineshwar, where Sri Ramakrishna did his tapasya. And also he had a photograph of Sri Ramakrishna. Very few people may know. A photograph which he eventually passed on to Champaklalji. He wanted to have that, you know, there is a dancing photograph of Sri Ramakrishna. Now, you know, here is Sri Aurobindo, not only a Cambridge graduate, But somebody who has mastered all this, both Indian thought, Western thought, recognizes in Sri Ramakrishna a master of great merit. It's not a joke. So it's one thing to read all these scriptures, quite another to walk the path. So life offers to us all the time, as Hasmukh Bhai was rightly saying, it's a 24/7 path. But it doesn't mean that we remain stiff and taut. The divine laughs, as we read in the morning, and we laugh with the divine. We can take a walk and walk with the divine. It's so true. When we are walking alone, we can walk with the divine. And it's such a joy and delight just to feel his presence and his company. We may not see him, but he sees us. There's a beautiful story of a blind saint who came for Sri Aurobindo's darshan. He had his own following, Swami Sharananda. And somebody asked him, you are going for darshan of Sri Aurobindo, but Sri Aurobindo will not speak anything and you can't see anything. So what kind of darshan is this? So he gave a wonderful reply. He said, all of you have eyes, but how much can you see? Lovely answer. I would repeat it in Hindi, the way he said. Bhaiya aankhe hoti, to kitna dekh lete? If you had eyes, how much would you see? I am not going so that I may see Mother and Sri Aurobindo. I am going so that their gaze falls upon me. This is the attitude of the sadhak. This is surrender. And every moment life gives us countless opportunity to align our will. Then once we start this, next we begin to say, all this time I am following my agenda and the divine seems to be sometimes a spoil sport and sometimes seems to okay. So after a while we say, okay, let me know what the divine agenda is, what the divine plan is for me. So that is the next step of aligning the will. First is we renounce the fruits. Second is we renounce the work and wait for the divine's inspiration. After many years of serving the Mother and Sri Aurobindo with an unflinching faith and devotion, Champak Lal ji prays to the mother, Mother, all these years I have served you the way I wanted to serve you. Grant me that I may serve you henceforth the way you want me to serve you. What a lovely prayer is this. So this is how we align this will which has deviated. And how this gets aligned more and more as the secret soul, the psychic being comes out. There's a very beautiful line in the Vedas, Rig Vedas, full of hymns to the Agni, where it is said, the Rishi invokes the Agni and says, it will make the crooked straight. Now what is this crooked? The will which is deviated by the ego. Ego deviates the will, just like water distorts the straight stick and it gives it a bend. It bends it. And it's an illusion, but it bends it. So similarly, our consciousness deviates the divine will. It deviates the divine love. It deviates the divine force. The mother says that, my child, you do not know. You know, when people ask that, mother, so much money is being wasted in the ashram. She says, you are worried about money? You don't know how much consciousness is wasted here? And how it is wasted? Through gossiping, chit-chatting, useless things. She says, I'm pouring. All the energy that is given to you for transformation, you throw it away. But she is a mother. She continues to pour. There is no end to her pouring. There is no end to her wasting. So this is how the heart begins to get aligned, where we begin to love not only the mother here, but the mother in the saint, the mother in the wicked, the mother in the vile, the mother in the fallen, the mother in the lowly. All distinctions we make in normal life of high and low, this religion, that caste, this language, that culture, they vanish. Because are we not all children of the same divine mother? So automatically when we practice, how is it to be practiced? By holding this idea in the mind. This is meditation. Meditation is not closing the eyes and sitting bolt straight with elbows straight and, you know, spine curved according to anatomical position. That is exercise, not meditation. Meditation is to let this idea fill the brain. that all is in the divine is in all, and all is the divine. We read yesterday, this morning, Mother saying, think about it. She says, the divine is everywhere. You have only to think about it. And then from the brain, like a tremendous, powerful energy, it begins to spread. Because when we hold, it's very simple law of physics. When we hold an idea with a tremendous intensity, Swami Vivekananda spoke about it. Take up one idea, contemplate upon it, let it enter your fibers, your veins. So after a while, the energy that is generated by this one idea, it can be any idea. It can be simply ma, 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 ma. And this idea begins to generate tremendous energy of a very different kind. People have headaches. They start feeling in the beginning when they go to the ashram, they say, oh, I'm feeling very sleepy. And they blame it on Pondicherry weather. But the real blame is, not blame. It is the Divine Mother's lap. So then this idea begins to spread into our eyes, giving our new sight. Spreads into our ears, giving us a new hearing, inner hearing of the Vedas, that which the inspired seers heard. The seven rivers begin to flow into our speech and throat. How beautifully Sri Aurobindo says, the golden light came down into my brain. The grey rooms of my mind sun-touched became a bright reply to wisdom's occult flame, occult plane, a calm illumination and a flame. This is how this brain becomes light. And then he says, the golden light came down into my throat. And all my speech is now a song divine. See how Sri Aurobindo says very, very powerfully an experience, which passingly, there are glimpses of this. Kabir says, he says, Jo bolu so ved kahava, jahan pag dharun so tirath. Whatever I speak is Veda. It's not Vedas that I speak. What I speak is Veda. It's not holy places I go, but wherever I step, that is a holy place. Jo bolun so ved kahava, jahan pag dharun so tirath. Sri Aurobindo says, the golden light came down into my throat, and all my speech is now a song divine, a pain song of thee, my single note, my words are drunk with the immortal's wine. The golden light came down into my heart, smiting my life with thy eternity. All these barriers, hearts, narrow. Me, my family, my immediate ones, my near ones, my dear ones. They vanish before the creed without limits, cult without limits. That's how Sri Aurobindo, the mother prays. How, O God of love, how I cherish for thee a cult without limits. The golden light came down into my heart, smiting my life with thy eternity. Now has it grown a temple where only thou art. This is the temple. Instead of visiting all these temples and cleaning there and doing things, this is the temple to be kept clean. Now has it grown a temple where only thou art, and all my passions flow towards only thee. This is aligning the passions. Our passions, our energies are in 101 works. Slowly we have to win their allegiance and turn them towards the Divine Mother, towards her work, her service, in whatever way. Doesn't matter, as a squirrel, fair enough. As a monkey, we don't know how to serve. She will teach us. We don't know what to do. She will give us the work. None is useless in her eyes, none small in her vision. For her, all children are equal, and she gives her love equally to all. And then the very body, the golden light, came down into my feet. My earth is now thy playfield and thy seat. To offer this very body to the divine, to make it his playfield, kridasthali, kridangan, how beautiful life would become. So this is how the alignment comes. We have to win back these energies which are given to the ego, usurped by the ego, and turn them towards the divine. So there will be a period when first they will undergo purification. Straight away the divine is not going to say, okay, fine, from today, you are my stamped, branded instrument. We would collapse with the ego of the instrument, more dangerous than the ordinary egos. Ah, I am an instrument of God. Afterwards, God is forgotten. I am an instrument. Ego comes in a different way from the back door. You know, you are an instrument of God. Indispensable instrument, gone. Ego has many masks. And it can enter in 1,000 ways. So to surrender more and more every time. So these energies, when we turn towards the Divine Mother, they have to go through a process of purification. And purification sometimes takes long. Sometimes it's painful. Painful to the ego. That's why we have to go through the nights of the soul, as the Christian mystics spoke about it. During these nights, what is happening? The poison is being eliminated. But we may wonder, where is the face of the Divine Mother? She has thrown us into the red heat of hell. No, she is waiting to forge the steel out of the raw iron that we are. It takes time. Through life journey, every experience will turn into a catalyst to go towards the divine. This is the third process of this yoga. That each and every experience, however small or big, is used by the divine artificer to mold us into the divine nature. Very often the smallest experiences are the one where we are more likely to stumble. Imagine somebody going on a scooter. I don't know, here we don't see scooters. Well, in India it's a common sight to go on scooter, and youngsters go high speed. You know, it's easy to avoid the big mountains. You know, okay, yeah, this is a big stone. So you take a turn. But where do we stumble? On the little stones which are lying on the path unseen. What are these little stones? Somebody suddenly says, oh, it's okay, ma, but you know what? You're not looking good. Little stone. I think you are growing old. Or something else, something which you don't like, something unpleasant. Many such experiences. Someone says harsh words to us, and always in this world there are people who say harsh words, unkind words. And we should pity them, because you know, it means how much harshness and bitterness they are carrying inside them. So whenever I meet such a person, I really pity. I pray that, you know, God, you know, if a snake loves, what he will do? He will only spit venom. Even his love is venomous. So poor fellow has spit a small portion outside. You know, when a snake bites, it's a fact that only this medical knowledge but applies to yoga. See how everything is yoga. All life is yoga. When snakes bite, one of the things we have to tell the person that look, only 1/10 of the venom is injected, which is a fact. Most often, snakes inject only 1/10 of the venom. That's why, you know, there's good hope for everybody. But it also means 9/10 they have swallowed inside, poor fellows. So people who are perpetually angry, bitter, and you know, caustic about life, about others, about everything, how much poison they are carrying inside. So Christ had such a fine analysis. So no wonder he said, forgive them. They don't know what they are doing. And every time we allow our speech to be carried away by such things, we are in fact only perpetuating this poison within us. So all these are wonderful opportunities for yoga, where we have to win their allegiance from the lower nature, the lower network of forces, and put them in tune with the higher nature. Then and only then can we have a free play of the Divine Mother in our life. It's not like that I'll remain in the lower network of forces. And then suddenly, you know, every time I call, the Divine Mother should be there at my disposal to do, save me from everything. She comes, but that is her. Well, to use the word greatness is to belittle, but yes, that's her greatness, her love. But something I must do from my side. If I remain all the time tied to these outposts of nature, whose names are lust and anger and greed and jealousies and fears, and I keep saying that, no, mother should do something, mother should do that, mother should protect me, mother should do. It doesn't work out like that. They have to be rejected from nature. And she will help us to reject, but we have to be sincere about it. So I don't know, I'm feeling a bit too inspired, but it's we should stop because we'll continue the inspiration subsequently in the session tomorrow.